Ek verwelkom nou vir Musie Maimane, leier van die DA, Bantu Lemisa, president van die UDM, en Musie Lekota, president van COPE. Die EFF is ook nog vanaand se gesprek genooi, maar wou nie van die geleentheid gebruik maak nie. Mr. Maimane, welcome. I want to start with you. After the departure of Jacob Zuma, what on earth is there that still unifies opposition parties?
Ja, baie dankie en dis baie goed om hier te wees. I think it's absolutely important to remind ourselves that the role of opposition isn't just to focus on one individual. We've always maintained that for the realignment of South African politics, we need to be able to find each other on critical issues. Even the issue on Jacob Zuma was more about the defense of the Constitution. It's about ensuring that we can actually deliver basic services to people, that actually we build a coalition of South Africans around a non-racial future. And therefore, ultimately, these values are issues that we must contend for regardless of who is the leader of the party in government so that we can advance these values for the purposes of the people of this country.
Mr. Lemisa, the UDM has been a committed opponent of Mr. Zuma and of the ANC for many years, but are now considering switching perhaps sides in Nelson Mandela Bay. How will your party vote on the 6th of April in this motion of no confidence against Mr. Trollope?
We have not yet discussed that, but be informed that the United Democratic Movement is still part of the coalition. In Johannesburg, for instance, we chair the SCOPA in that municipality. Sadly, in Port Elizabeth, there was a breakdown of communication, and we accepted that maybe sanity will prevail one day.
Let's just quickly look at the graphic of Nelson Mandela Bay's council. So the UDM really holds the key there to keep this coalition going. If you decide to vote with the EFF's motion, the ANC might govern there. Is that an outcome that you could possibly live with, given the corrupt nature of the ANC?
I'm not sure about the corruption, as to use it as one yardstick. The DA and ANC did form a coalition after 2016 election. You remember around the coastline here, there was a municipality which they shared the platform together against that civil organization. So the issue of coalitions is not cast in stone between UDM and DA only. So politics of the day dictates what decisions to take. But for now, we have not yet taken any decision.
Mr. Lekota, so the land motion that was debated and adopted in Parliament very recently has divided opposition parties that cooperate in many of the councils. What do you think was the main motivation behind that motion, if not to solve the land problem?
Look, I've been watching the report over a period of time. It is quite clear to me that the reportage has been very, very misleading. There's been a suggestion that Parliament adopted a motion to amend the Constitution. That's a fallacy. Parliament adopted a motion to review. There was a phrase there, and amend, and it was expressly removed.
Yes, but you voted against this motion, as did Mr. Maimane's party. Why?
We voted against that because we see no need to review the Constitution. I want to state on this program emphatically and without any hesitation, the Congress of the People stands very firm on the position on which we left the ANC. When Zuma said that the ANC is above the Constitution, we said no, we can't be led by you. We still say that today. We said that at the time when the Constitution already said no one may be deprived of their properties, that there can be no expropriation. Well, it did say, the Constitution said there may be expropriation on condition, among others, that there is compensation. And we stay absolutely firm on this issue. South Africans must defend this Constitution. We discussed this constitution, we drew it up. Cyril Ramaphosa was the scribe of President Mandela there. And we thought it's because we came from jail, we were not very attractive to the electorate at the time. But I think we made a mistake. He didn't know what he was writing.
Mr. Olumisa, I mean, constitutional experts are united on the issue that the Constitution is no impediment to land reform since 1996. Why support a motion to put in place a process which could lead to the amendment of the Constitution?
Well, you are speaking to a person who has been advocating for a roundtable discussion to finish off the work we didn't finish at World Trade Center, that of emancipation of economic emancipation of the majority citizen in this country. Part of that is the question of land. I supported that motion when it was amended to the effect that South Africans, through the Constitutional Review Committee, will be given an opportunity to sit down and find a solution. Therefore, I still maintain that President Cyril Ramaphosa right now, he should address the nation and explain to the people of South Africa that they mustn't panic, but we are giving everybody an opportunity to address this issue because it has taken so long. We know that there was a plan to implement the land issues, but because of the administration, which blundered, we're back to square one. But we have a rider now to say, let's go and sit and find a solution. Remember that in South African conflict, there were no winners. It was South Africa which won, and the round tables discussion. So we will find a solution through this process we're starting.
Okay, but many of those, including Mr. Maimane's party, believe that there is reason, if not to panic, then to be very concerned. And I want to read from an SMS, Mr. Maimane, that was sent out by your party today to supporters and prospective supporters. The ANC wants law changes so that the state can control private property. Do you think that that really is a risk? Because that's the EFF's position. Is that really the ANC's position?
Well, I think the moment you take away and you amend even Section 25, which is the destination to which this, particularly clauses that speak to compensation, clauses that speak to what use of land can be in place, clauses that speak to private property rights, then naturally it has to end up in the hands of the state. And to me, it's a complete antithesis to, firstly, the evidence. The historical evidence demonstrates the fact that the Constitution has not been the impediment to land restitution. And ultimately, the ultimate issue here, in fact, restated in the high-level panel report by former President Kgalema Motlanthe, cites the fact that it's actually corrupt officials and an incapable state. So why are we now sitting today in a world where we should be attracting investment, where we should be supporting that even black South Africans whose land was dispossessed have an opportunity to own that in their own private right? Why are we signaling to the international community, to South Africans in general, that actually we have a preference for them to be tenants of the state?
Why do you distrust the president so much? He says, don't panic, we won't harm the economy, and food production will increase.
There have been a number of presidents who have gone down this route before. And Deputy President, President Ramaphosa, if you look at even in simplistic terms, if you look at the Zimbabwean model as an example, it was seen as a national liberation movement losing its ability to be able to speak to the electorate about its capability to deliver, and then subsequent to that, then sitting back and saying, let's blame air race, or let's rather expropriate in this regard. And my greatest challenge is that you can look at many examples, Venezuela, and we can keep going. Our stance is that if we want to advance economic emancipation of all South Africans, then part of that is ensuring that South Africans can own property in their own rights and that people can invest with the confidence that there's security of tenure so that in agriculture we can achieve the long-term objectives of it. President Ramaphosa has shown that given the pressure, he's been able to accommodate people in his own cabinet who come from different factions and so forth, showing South Africans that he's not always in charge of the ANC.
Right, but he is an ace negotiator, Mr. Lekota, as he showed us during the constitutional negotiating process. Should we not trust that he means it when he says that he'll manage this process very, very carefully so as to limit the damage to, for example, investor confidence? Even farmers are saying they'll hold back on investment until there's certainty.
They'll hold back. You see, that very phrase You don't say to the masses of people in any country, we are going to take the property of other citizens and give it to others. And then you say you are keeping it in control. You don't do that because you are creating expectations which have no possibility of achievement. Now, let me say this absolutely frankly and firmly. President Cyril Ramaphosa has walked deep into a storm he does not understand. We, since 1912 to 1949, pleaded with the government of the time to find resolution to the problems of our country peacefully. By 1948, apartheid was introduced. More aggressive apartheid legislation was introduced. Our people at the 49 conference took a position that we are now going to go extra constitutional. Until now, we have complained but remained within the law. But between 49 and 1960, our people took a decision to break unjust laws. Then the organizations of the people were banned. Then they upped the ante. We are going to armed struggle. But even at that time, they said, but as soon we are taking up arms, not to kill white people, but to pressure this regime to negotiate settlement. And the moment the government agrees to negotiate, we will be the first ones to put our arms down and give negotiation a chance. Sir, we did that when F.V.A. de Klerk, after Foster died, after P.W. lost, and F.V.A. said, let's negotiate. I was part of the population in the jails. We came out, we said, look, we are going to do it. At CODESA, look at the preamble of our constitution. We all agreed, let us put weapons down, let us negotiate a settlement, create conditions in which we can solve the problems of the time peacefully, okay, in a stable atmosphere.
Yeah.
This man has disrupted it, Cyril has disrupted it.
Yes, but this is
Zuma.
A very different time, Mr. Hulumisa, in which parties are debating very different issues to those that were discussed at CODESA. I mean, do you believe still that there's enough that your party has in common with your colleague to your left and your colleague to your right to co-govern in the big metros, for example, in Gauteng? Or do you think that that will also be threatened in these coming months?
The situation here, we must not get too excited. There is a problem in this country of the helping the majority citizens of South Africa. Therefore, by saying, let's go and sit around the table, we want to find a solution.
Yes, but the ANC wants power.
No. Wait, man. Don't worry about ANC. This process is open to all South Africans. Let DA come and present their position in that review process. Let COPE, EFF, ANC, the farming community, the big business, and so on, the traditional leaders, King Zwelithini must come and say, what do you mean when you say we cannot review Ingonyama Trust? What are the implications of that? You are now given an opportunity to come forward. So I'm not interested in pressing panic buttons for now. I'm happy with that process of consultation. We have to find a solution, like we did at CODESA.
Okay, if you don't like pressing panic buttons, you don't have much in common with Julius Malema, who enjoys pressing them every day.
Julius Malema is representing his own view.
Okay.
He's got a different view. I have a different view. He has a different view. But all these views must be put in one basket and sift them and come up with a solution.
Right, but the distance...
No one party is going to run South Africa alone.
Fair enough, but the distance between parties, of some opposition parties, on certain issues, Mr. Maimane, is growing. The EFF's position, for example, on issues of race, cannot easily be reconciled with the DA's position. You even took Mr. Malema to the Equality Court this week. How much longer can you defend to DA voters working with a party that so clearly detests many of your supporters, white and black.
No, and I think we should not kid ourselves. The signals that are coming, even in those statements, are not consistent with our constitution, are not consistent with the reconciliation project we're trying to build. That's why I think it was fair to say the EFF must stand on its own and they must support us on items they want us to support us in, and they mustn't on other items. We've agreed that in metros that we govern, we should pass budgets. Those budgets must focus on the poor. Service delivery must continue. We must oppose corruption. And in that instance, I think there's common ground. But we would certainly not tolerate utterances when somebody says that they are not willing to commit genocide against white people just yet. That is unacceptable. That's why we will take it to the Equality Court.
Okay,
because we'd never sacrifice, in the interest of power, the very principle of reconciliation.
Right, but they are trying to hold you ransom in Nelson Mandela Bay, right?
And that's why we will not shy away from the principle. That's why we voted against that motion. The EFF had written to me on that morning, and I took a firm view to say, look, it's not that we're opposed to land restitution. We support it. We want it to work within the framework of the Constitution. But if you say to us we must then amend the very same Constitution that guarantees everybody's rights, or you'll remove us out of power, then what principle people are we? Coalitions can only work if you're willing to also stand up and say, this is a principle and we will fight for it and we'll fight for all South Africans.
Mr. Lemisa, one of our viewers expressed on Twitter a desire that you and Mr. Maimane kiss and make up on the show tonight and commit to working together in Nelson Mandela Bay.
The United Democratic Movement and Democratic Alliance are in coalition. We have discussed the issue of Mr. Bobane and Mr. Trollip. I am the one who signaled early that maybe we should seriously consider to withdraw these two people, because it looks as though there's a clash of personalities right at the beginning, even before the allegations of corruption and this and that, which have been investigated, and we're still waiting to hear where is this prima facie evidence they were talking about. So I am in the coalition in Johannesburg, but for Port Elizabeth, I think the whole process has been overtaken. Remember that the keys are with the EFF in these three metros.
Mr. Lekota, very briefly, drawing to a close, are you more of an optimist about the country's future now after Mr. Ramaphosa's election in December than you were last year?
No, sir. I am as optimistic as I was when I was released from Robben Island back in 89. This country will go into its future on the basis of the constitution we negotiated under the leadership of President Mandela. It's no question of choice. Lots of people imagine this thing. We have this coalition, and the future will be even more coalitions if need be. South Africa is a big country. It's got a varied population. But the numbers that will support the approach created at CODESA will always be increasing and going forward.
And that will also depend on the three of you. That's all we have time for. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Bly ingeskakel. Kyk net verslag in gesprek. Gaan net hier na voor.